Everyone, welcome. Thank you for joining us on the Simple Tax Strategy That Will Lower Your Tax Liability webinar. First of all, I want to thank iCare's management and staff for giving us this opportunity to bring you unsurmountable, valuable information that you can implement into your business right now with regards to your taxes. I want to start with something that's kind of odd. And I want you guys to realize that there are two sets of rules when it comes to the tax code. There's a rule for the informed, and there's a rule for the uninformed. And those situations we're going to address now. And throughout the day, throughout this webinar, I'm hoping that by the end of it, you become informed. So at Daycare Accounting Pro, our mission is to impact the financial health of over 850,000 childcare businesses in the United States by strategically showing them how taxes, bookkeeping, and payroll can be used as a tool to grow their business. Daycare owners suffer an inherent number of challenges. Accounting should not be one. So as in business, we all need fans and people that appreciate our work. This is Doris from Doris Daycare, and she had the following to say about David. David was recommended to me about 8 years ago because I received a workers' comp penalty audit and was frantic because I was paying my employees on a 1099. And we all know how that is a no-no for the childcare industry. Continuing, he first calmed me down, then he explained what we needed to do. And I have to say he advised me correctly. He was able to waive my $15,000 penalty and put me on the right path. Love you, David. Love you too, Doris. This is Nakia Whitson from Brainiac Babies. She says, let me start by saying David is amazing. Love the sound of that. I started working with David with my business and personal taxes 5 years ago, and he has saved me thousands. And by thousands, we're talking about five-figure thousands. I highly recommend David for tax services. He knows his stuff real well, and he will always educate you throughout the process. I will not change him for the world. Now, I have a little story to tell you about Nakia. Since she's been with me, I've been sharing information, sharing knowledge, so much so that last year, she went and started her own tax prep business. How's that for entrepreneurship? And I appreciate her, and I thank her for allowing me to be a part of that. Okay, so one of the biggest mistakes, one of the biggest fines that we find when we speak to childcare owners is that they're choosing the wrong business entity. And we're going to go in depth into this because this is critical for your business. The consequences of choosing wrong business types can be devastating tax-wise to your business. Too many daycare owners right now are paying a huge amount of tax that could have been avoided. And I'll give you an example on that pretty soon. So right now, if you're not aware, there are four types of business entities. There's the sole proprietorship. There's a subchapter S, which is also known popularly as the S-Corp. There's the C-Corporation, also known as the C-Corp. And there's a partnership. Now, roughly 75%, I would say maybe a little more, of the childcare owners whom we service had these same exact issues of paying too much tax. And it was partly due to the lack of knowledge of the tax code. Remember how I mentioned before that there are two rules? 75% are in the uninformed rule. Now, because of that, one of the first questions that we ask when we had these consultations is how are you being taxed and what type of business entity are you? And 9 times out of 10, everyone says they're an LLC. And I'm sure on this call, there are half of you are probably LLCs. But the question is, how are you being taxed? Now, Vicky, one of our clients, had the same situation. It was about 5 years ago, one of these cold winter nights in New York. I was invited to do a seminar for small business owners. And the topic of that seminar was, if you want to run your business differently, you must think differently. And I was going through my speech. There was a woman sitting all the way in the back that caught my attention. And she caught my attention because she was strongly, I mean, she was going nuts, the way the notes that she was writing. She was taking out excellent notes. And I kind of gravitated towards her because she was so focused on what I was saying. So when we got to the Q&A section of the seminar, she mentioned that she was a childcare business owner. And she had tons of questions. It got to the point where we closed down the seminar and she decided she wanted to walk me to my car. We went a couple of blocks and we continued our discussion as to why she was paying so much in tax. When we got to my car, now still in the cold, I can see that look of frustration and despair and anguish that business owners typically have when they're overwhelmed with tax situations. And as we were discussing her situation, tears started running down her eyes because, like she says, she was sick and tired of being sick and tired of trying to figure out a way to pay less tax because she was basically drowning in the taxes that she was paying. So I kind of calmed that down and explained to her, hey, you know what? You're not alone. I was in that same situation myself. In 2005, the IRS was hitting me up for $75,000. And I can remember the anguish and the despair that I felt. I felt hopeless every time I received a notice from the IRS. And we all know what that notice looks like the moment we get it. Just those three little letters, IRS, can bring so much fear and anxiety into our lives that it's incredible. I can usually tell because now we're going into tax season and when clients are calling in to make appointments, I can feel the anxiety that they have. They're nervous because it's tax time. And Vicky was going through the same situation. So I told her, listen, come down, let's schedule an appointment. The very next day, she sent me her tax return. The first thing I look at is what is she paying in taxes? And I come to realize that she was a single member LLC and she was paying about $15,000 in self-employment tax. Light bulb went off in my head and I knew immediately what the problem was. So I recommended that we switch her business entity from a sole proprietor to an S corp. And that single strategy without taking any deductions saved her roughly a little bit more than $20,000. That's incredible. Now, unlike other business owners, she didn't take the $20,000 in savings and go on vacation and buy a new car. She actually listened to me. She took my advice. I told her, take that money, invest in more employees so that you can grow your business. Not only did she grow the business, she went from an in-home family to a center within a year. That's huge. Now, how did that come about? Because now she had a structure. She knew exactly where she was going. She knew that if she could increase her revenue and not worry about the accounting, that she will be in a path where she could increase her revenues exponentially. And that's exactly what she did. So going from an in-home to a center within a year is huge. Now, over the last 10 years, too many childcare owners are paying too much in tax. Too many are frustrated, sorting out their bookkeeping on a daily basis, and some have no idea what to do with payroll. My name is David Encarnacion, and for the last decade, I have helped hundreds of childcare owners just like you to achieve peace of mind by providing strategies that lower the tax liability. So in the next 20 to 30 minutes, I will show you how to pay less tax. So let's talk about the elephant in the room, these LLCs. I know everyone wants an LLC. You probably opened your LLC because another provider told you that they have an LLC. You probably opened an LLC because influencers, TikTokers, YouTubers are talking about LLCs. And I'm upset with that. I'm upset because everyone is talking about these LLCs, but no one is addressing the tax consequences that come with creating an LLC. Now, what's an LLC? An LLC is just a business structure that's allowed by the state. The owners of the LLC are considered members, but here's the trick. An LLC is considered, quote unquote, a disregarded entity in the face of the IRS. I'm gonna give you guys a little bit of homework. Let me ask you, first of all, on the chat, if you could put down LLC, if you are an LLC, I wanna see how many LLCs are in the call. So for homework, I want you to Google disregarded entity and see what you get. It's basically meaningless. It's a zero to the left. The IRS does not care. The only thing they want to know is, we're going to go back to the entities. How am I going to tax you? Am I going to tax you as a sole proprietor, an S corp, a C corp, or a partnership? It's the only thing that the IRS is interested in. Now, obviously, LLCs provide certain liability protection. So if you have assets and there's a lawsuit against the LLC, your assets cannot be touched. Now, this is kind of critical because there are certain rules and regulations with the LLCs that have to be maintained so that you do not, quote unquote, pierce the corporate veil. So the LLC is in that bubble, it's protected. You have to make sure that everything in that LLC is done properly so as not to pierce, make a hole in that bubble. Because if you pierce a hole in the bubble, now you're allowing yourself to be liable for certain situations. So the rules and regulations for LLCs are different. Currently, there are three states in which LLCs are extremely expensive. And that's New York, Arizona, and Nevada. And they're expensive because you have to do publishing. Publishing meaning that you have to put an ad in two periodicals, two publications, for 6 weeks consecutive. Now in New York, that could run anywhere between $1,200 and $1,500. That's why they're a little bit more expensive. LLCs are what we call a pass-through entity, which means all the income passes through to the owner or owners of the LLC. You get the same profit or loss. That profit and loss is taxed as personal income. So if you have a profit on your business as a sole proprietor, not only do you pay the self-employment tax, but you also pay income tax on that on your personal tax return. Go to the next slide. Now, you guys may want to take a picture of this because I want you to reference this later. I'm going to tell you how you can decipher whether or not you're a S corp, C corp, or sole proprietor or partnership. So when you filed your paperwork with the IRS, if you notice on the left side on the top, it says LLC and below it, it says member. That's indicating that this business created a tax ID as an LLC. The form is SS4 and the notice is CP, Charlie Paul 575. And it states, we assign to you an employer identification number. And on the middle of the page, this is the critical part, it will tell you what tax form you have to file and the date. So in this case, I know without knowing anything else, that a 1065 is a partnership tax return, which tells me that there are two or more members in the LLC. LLCs as a partnership have to file their tax return on before March 15th of the tax year. Go back to the previous one. So what are your options? As an LLC, you have several options. One of them is to elect how you want to be taxed. So electing to be taxed as an S corp does wonders for you. So I have a story about Melissa. Go to the two slides down. Melissa, spoke to Melissa. She came on board late December. So one of my first questions during our consultation, okay, Melissa, how are you being taxed and what type of business entity are you? Her response was, I'm an LLC. And I get that a lot. So a light bulb went off in my head, indicating that I need to probe a little more. So I asked her again, this time with a smile. Hey, Melissa, what type of business entity are you? She says she's an LLC. That tells me that she doesn't really know how she's being taxed. So I did a little probing, started digging in, asked her, email me your tax return. I want to review it. She did so. And the first thing I went to was to the Schedule 2. And you guys may want to take a picture of some of these slides. They will be available. The recording will be available and we'll email it to whoever needs it or wants it. But on the Schedule 2, I went to line 4. And guess what she was paying? $22,559 of self-employment tax. Now, that does not include income tax. That's a separate tax that Melissa's paying. Go down to the next line. Now, this is page 2 of the 1040. So if you notice the top line, 16 tax, 7,348, that's income tax. If we go down to line 23, if you read across, that self-employment tax of $22,559. When we add those two, we get a total of close to $30,000 in tax that she had to pay. Now, I know that if she were a client of ours, she became a client, I know this year that would not be the case. I know that this year, that line 23 would be zero. You heard correctly. We will take that $22,559 and turn that into a zero. And I'll explain to you how. Go back up to one more. So Melissa had the situation where she was paying the $22,000. So the first thing that we're going to do is convert her to an S corp. The moment we do that, now we'll be able to reduce that self-employment tax to zero. And I'm going to explain how self-employment tax works in a little bit. Now, everyone, all these TikTokers, YouTubers, accountants on social media, they're all telling you what deductions to take to lower your tax liabilities. I'm telling you that there are more important things to look at than just deductions. Go to the next one. Two more. One more. Another one. Okay, so let's talk about self-employment tax. So how much self-employment tax would you have to pay or will pay if you're filing as a sole proprietor? Self-employment tax is 15.3% of net profits, in which the employer pays 7.65%, which is half of the 15.3%, and the employee pays the other half, which is 7.65%. The fact that you're a sole proprietor means that you're both the employee and the employer. Therefore, you pay the entire 15.3%. So as an example, if you're filing your taxes as a sole proprietor and you have a net profit of $100,000, your self-employment tax will be around $15,000. Now, in order to Melissa's situation, we were able to solve it very simply, and that was by converting her to an S-corp. Now, what's an S-corp? An S-corp could be a corporation, INC, or an LLC. What you're doing as an S-corporation is that the owners are electing to be taxed as an S-corp, which means that income passes through from the business to your personal tax return. Example, as an S-corp, you will file a business tax return. Whether that's a profit or loss at the end of the year, that information will go on your personal tax return. So if it's a profit of $10,000, you would have a profit of $10,000 on your personal tax return. However, you will not have self-employment tax. In addition, if it's a loss, it will go on your personal tax return as a loss, and it will adjust any other income that you may have. Meaning, if you have $100,000 on a W-2 and you have a loss of $10,000, your gross income just went down to 90, which is huge. Now, an S corp must be a domestic corporation. And by domestic, I mean the owners have to be residents or citizens of the US. So I know I had a conversation last week with someone that's a C corp, and when I asked her, why are you a C corp? She couldn't tell me, but throughout the conversation, then I realized that one of her partners is not a resident and just got their social, and that's the reason for the C corp. But liabilities under S corp are limited. In order to become an S corp, there's certain forms you have to file with the IRS and state if applicable. Some states require that. So if you're in New York, if you're in the 50 states, you must file form 2553. If you're in New York, you have to file form 2553 plus the New York C Charlie Tom 6. New York is just a different animal. Now, you have the IRS every year gives you the first 75 days of the year. So from the 1st of January to March 15th to elect to be an S corp. And you will be electing to be an S corp for 2023 if we use this year. However, there's a late election relief, but the tax return has to be filed by March 15th. And the late election relief on the form 2553, you have to reference a specific tax law. It's called Rev Proc. Jose, put that in. Rev, R-E-V, Proc, P-R-O-C, 2013-30. You reference that tax law, and if you do it now, before March 15th, the IRS will give you retro S-Corp status back to January 1st of 2022. So for the year of 2022, even though you operate as a sole proprietor, the fact that you're using that late election relief will grant you S-Corp status for the prior year. Now, remember I said you have to file a business tax return timely for that to take into effect. The S-Corp does not pay corporate income tax, zero. Now, it's not even a tax. Depending on the state, they'll charge you a franchise fee. So in New York is $25, New Jersey is $75. They're usually under $100, but it's not a tax, it's just a fee. Now, because you are an S corp, the owners qualify for what is called QBDI, which is the qualified business income deduction, where the owner gets an additional 20% deduction on their personal tax return because the S corp is a pass-through entity. Remember, it's passing through the business, the corporation, and into your personal tax return. It also avoids what we call the double taxation on corporate income. I'm not gonna go into too much into the C corp, but I'll explain a little bit here. C corps are known for double taxation because the business tax return, when it's filed, you pay tax on the business tax return. On the S corp, you don't. But you pay tax on the C corp tax return, and any dividends that you receive, money that you take from the business, you also pay tax on your personal tax return, thereby double taxation. Now, since the IRS encourages us to, what's the word I'm looking for? Encourages us to avoid paying tax. They give us a blueprint. They give us a roadmap to avoid tax. There are over 800 plus deductions. And I'm certain you guys are probably using maybe 3 or 4, but there are over 800. Remember what I mentioned before, there are two rules, one for the informed and one for the uninformed. This is where that begins to work. This is how you avoid paying tax. This is how you hear rumors that Tesla, what's the other one? Amazon, all these billion-dollar companies are paying zero in tax. It's not a rumor, it's a fact, because they know exactly, they have a team of lawyers and accountants figuring out ways to pay less tax, because that's the IRS encourages us to avoid tax. So because we're trying to avoid tax as an S corp, the IRS now requires us to for the owners to pay themselves a reasonable wage in the form of a W-2. I got a story to tell you about W-2s. We have a client named David, not this David, another David. We converted him to an S corp, and he thought that he can beat the system. And he didn't realize that when you're informed, you're beating the system. But he decided not to take the W-2. Years went on. They may not catch you at that moment, but years went on. And a couple of years down the line, they showed up at his doorstep, knocked on his door for an audit. And in that audit, they look at the last 3 years of bank statements and the last 3 year of profit and loss statements. And they determine that if you do not have receipts for any withdrawals or payments you made from the business account, if you cannot provide proof in the form of a receipt or a valid explanation, that money or that payment that you made will be considered income to David. Needless to say, he ended up paying five figures in additional tax because he tried to work around the system when he could have used the system to save that money. Now, I don't know if you've heard, but the IRS is hiring 87,000 auditors over the next 10 years. When we analyze a tax return or we have a consultation, we look at it from the point of view of an auditor. And if I was an auditor, one of these 87,000 auditors, I would go for the low-hanging fruit. And the low-hanging fruit in this case would be an S corp in which the owner is not taking a W-2. Every day that you go on without taking a W-2, if you're an S corp, you're putting yourself at risk. Remember those 87,000 auditors that I mentioned? They're not going away. Are audits going to increase in the next 5-10 years? Count on it. And they're going to go after the low fruit, in this case, S corps. So if you're not going to address that tax issue, that W-2 issue, that payroll issue now, then when? Now, here are a few solutions on how you can avoid paying self-employment tax. The first one is make your S corp election to the IRS and the state. File that form 2553. And if there's a form for the state, make sure you file that as well. You have to pay yourself a W-2. S corp owners are required to take a reasonable wage. And for childcare industry, our recommendation is anywhere between 8 to 10% of the gross income. So depending on the state that you live, you're between 8 and 12. If you live in a place like New York, you're around on the high end, the 12%, because the cost of living is more expensive here. If you're in Arkansas, maybe around 8%. The point being, if you're generating a gross revenue, I'm going to use these numbers as illustration. If you're generating $100,000 and you live in Florida, you should be paying yourself a W-2 in the amount of, let's say, $10,000. Now, why are we using that number, $10,000? Because remember, that $90,000 that's left does not pay self-employment tax, only pays income tax. Number four, focus on tax planning rather than tax preparation. Too many tax preparers, when you bring them your documentation, they just prepare your tax return. They're not looking for ways to tax plan to save you money. So if you've been filing a sole proprietor for X amount of years and you've been paying that self-employment tax, shame on your preparer, because you should have gotten to the point where you will be able to save on that money. Number five, execute tax strategies. Every tax strategy, and I'm going to share some with you, you should use to lower your tax liability. If it's available, use it. Even if it brings your net income or loss, it doesn't matter. you take the loss, but make sure you execute and use all of them. Now, your job as a child care owner is very simple. You have one job, and that's to provide a safe, nurturing, educational experience for the children in your care. That's it. Your job is not to wear 15 hats, which I'm sure all of you do. You're the CEO, you're the janitor, you're the parent therapist, you're the child therapist, and chances are you're probably a debt collector, because when parents don't pay, you have to go chasing after them. That's not your job. Now, I don't know if you've heard, in an 18-month period during the pandemic, more than 17,000 childcare businesses closed. And the reason they're closed, because of lack of revenue. Revenue is king. And when you're lacking in revenue, it's because you're working on in the business, not working on the business. Your job as a CEO, we have a saying here, you can't be the CEO or the account. You're either the CEO or the account. You can't do both. You have to be the CEO and manage your business, increase your revenue exponentially, and then you can do whatever you like. Now, one of the things you also have to do is manage parents' expectations and concerns. Increasing revenue should be your only focus. If you look at a profit and loss statement, there's one line on that statement that matters. That's the income line. And is at the top, and is one single line, because that's what drives everything. The more income you have, the more expenses you'll get, but you'll be able to afford to pay them. But the only way to do that is to increase that income. And we had a client, I don't know, 2 weeks ago. I was having a consultation with her, and she was mentioning to me that she spends about 20 hours a week doing bookkeeping and payroll. Blew my mind. I said, really? 20 hours a week? Even on the weekends? Yeah, even on the weekends. So as I'm an accountant, we look at things logically. So I broke down the numbers for her. Okay, so you're spending 20 hours a week. If you multiply that times 52 weeks, that's 1,040 hours a year that you're spending doing bookkeeping and payroll and accounting data. Okay, we divide that 1,040 hours by 24 hours in a day, it gives us 43 days. Now, let me ask you guys, what could you do with 43 additional days? One, you can go on vacation, a month for it, or you can spend those 43 days increasing your revenue. That's about a fourth of income. So if you're making $100,000 and you use those additional 43 days, it should increase your income by at least $25,000. But she wasn't realizing this because she was caught up working in the business. That's why it's so important for you to step out and work on the business and have someone else handle those accounting data procedures. Now, if you're in this situation, you need someone to help you avoid these pitfalls. Someone who will be able to structure a plan where your accounting, your bookkeeping, your taxes, payroll are being handled, so that at the end of the day, you can have peace of mind. Now, these are specific tax strategies that are going to lower your liability. Take a picture of it, even though the webinar will be available. The first one is a SEP IRA, S-E-P IRA. Now, if you don't know what that is, it's very simple. As an S-Corp owner, you're allowed from your net income to put up to $61,000 or 25%, whichever is less, into a SEP IRA. I'll give you an example using numbers. Let's say you have $200,000 of net income. You could take $50,000, drop it into a SEP IRA, in which that's a $50,000 savings for you for your retirement. That $50,000 is also a deduction. So it brings your net income from 200 to 150. You can't beat that. That's a win-win. I venture to say, I would like to know how many of you have a SEP IRA, but we'll discuss that later. Second, pay your spouse. Put them on payroll, your spouse and your kids. We usually recommend anywhere between 10 to 12 years old and open a Roth IRA for them. So in order to open a Roth IRA, you have to have earned income. That's the key there. If you don't have earned income, you cannot open a Roth or contribute to it. But you can contribute $6,500 every year into that account. I'm going to give you my example. My kids, when they were younger, I had them on payroll. The money that they earned, the $6,000, I dropped it into a Roth IRA. So if I did that for 10 years, that's $60,000. By the time they're 25, that account should be in the vicinity of $1 million. That's huge. Now, I'll give you another example. If you have a newborn and you have a website, you take a picture of your newborn and you drop it onto the website. All of a sudden, little Johnny is now an employee of the company because you're using his picture on your website and you pay him $6,000. And that $6,000 that you're paying him, you drop it into a Roth. Now imagine dropping a Roth, dropping $6,000 every year in a Roth for Johnny for the next 18 years. These are the type of tax strategies that you have to take advantage of. Not only will they lower your tax, it's going to provide financial planning going forward and generational wealth for your entire family. Remember, there are two rules, one for the informed and one for the uninformed. And I'm hoping that this information will inform you. Use the healthcare insurance strategy. If you're a sole proprietor and you do not have health insurance, if you use this strategy, you will be able to have health insurance and have it deducted from your income or from your revenue. That's huge. There's the Augusta rule. A lot of people like to talk about the Augusta rule, and it's basically for 2 weeks out of the year, your business, ABC childcare or daycare, is paying $2,000 in rent for those 2 weeks to the owner, in which the $2,000 is deductible from the business, and the $2,000 that the owner received is not considered income. Fine and dandy, but let's step it up a notch. Rent the house or rent the home from your spouse. Pay them $2,000 every month. That's $24,000 in a year. Guess what? If you're a sole proprietor, that's $24,000 less of net income, which means that's $24,000 in which you do not have to pay self-employment tax on. Huge. I recommend prepaying subscriptions or vendors. If you have a huge net income by the end of the year, prepay some of those vendors just to take it off your plate. For instance, if you have a location and your rent is $3,000 and you have the net income and you pay the full year in advance and you send that check in on the 30th, the landlord is going to get on 2023. So he's going to report that in the year that he's supposed to, but you'll be able to take that deduction for 2022. That's $36,000 of deduction plus whatever rent you pay throughout the year, which is big. You have to take advantage, and I don't know how many of you know are familiar with 100% bonus depreciation. So 100% bonus depreciation expired let me elaborate. The 100% portion expired at the end of this year. And every year going forward, it's going to go down 20%. So for 2023, it goes down to 80%, then 60, then 40, until it gets to zero in 2027. What does that mean? That if you purchased a vehicle for your business, you purchased a van to pick up and drop off kids. The van is over 6,000 pounds. Let's say it costs you $50,000. And let's say for illustration purposes, you have a net income of $50,000. If you take 100% bonus depreciation, the $50,000 washes out and brings your net income to zero. That's how you pay zero tax. Next, schedule strategy sessions with your accountant. I recommend starting in September through December, just so you can take advantage of all the different strategies you can use and use that time to put them into place. Most importantly, be coachable. There are clients that are coachable, some that aren't. Be coachable. If you're coachable, you'll be informed. Now, the most common question I get is, David, can you help my childcare business to pay less tax, to get on the right path? And the answer is absolutely yes. I speak with daycare owners daily. Businesses ranging, whether you're family in-home, FCC, a center, Head Start, multiple locations, whether you're making $50,000 a year or several million. Doesn't matter. Now, the next step for you to do is to use these tax strategies. And we have two eBooks available that I'll, if you request, I'll send. One is for sole proprietors and one is for S Corp. The next step will be to schedule a 20-minute phone call with us, where we're going to review your current processes and procedures. The first question we're going to ask is, how are you being taxed? What type of entity you are? We're going to share tax strategies with you that you can implement right now into your business. You're going to receive the eBooks that have additional more strategies. We're going to be able to do any type of projections. It's a getting to know each other. We want to know exactly where you are, where you plan to go, and how can we help. The purpose is that if you tell us your goal in the next 12 months is to become a center and you're an in-home, our purpose is to help you accomplish that just by using these numbers. Remember what I said before? We have to use these tools, these tax tools, bookkeeping, payroll, to grow the business. No one talks about that, but that could be done. Now, what does this offer mean for you? It means that after our call, you'll know exactly what tax strategies you can use right now and apply to your business. You're going to know exactly what strategies you can use in the future. You're going to know if we're a good fit to work together, and you'll be in a position of strength where now you can make a informed, going back to that two rules, informed decision as to how you're going to move forward. Now, if you're on this webinar and you're an iCare subscriber, you're entitled to a bonus. The bonus is, first of all, the 20-minute call is free, but this bonus, if you choose one of our all-inclusive tax and bookkeeping bundles and payroll bundles, you get an additional 10% off, which is a huge substantial savings. And I thank iCare for making that happen for you guys. Now, I want you guys to, you know, picture a day when you have peace of mind, because now you don't have to worry about your accounting, your bookkeeping, your payroll. Picture a day when your neighbor comes running to you and asks you, you going on vacation again? That's me. Yeah. Going on vacation again. Yeah. And he or she is going to say, you know, how do you get to do that? You must be lucky. Picture a day when you're living the life you lead and you're loving it. Now, whether you are a solopreneur, in-home, FCC, center, Head Start, this offer will transform your business in any economy. Remember the 17,000 childcare businesses that close? With this offer, you will be put in a position where you practically guarantee this is not going to happen, because now you're going to be spending more time working on your business rather than in the business. Now, I'm going to leave you with this, and then we're going to go into the Q&A. You deserve peace of mind knowing that your taxes are accurately and completely being prepared. You deserve peace of mind knowing that you can go on vacation and enjoy yourself without having to worry. You deserve peace of mind knowing that your bookkeeping is accurate and in order. At the end of the day, as a childcare owner, you deserve peace of mind. And with that, I thank you. Go to the next one. If you want to contact us, this is our information. We service all 50 states. If you get to that website, they're currently working on it, so you may not be able to log in, but that's our website, and that's our address here in New York City. And if you want to get in touch with iCare, here is their information.